Let me say a few words about Victor. Victor studied physics in Granada, Spain, and then moved to Mallorca to study at the Institute for Cross-Disciplinary Physics and Complex Systems. After the master, he did his PhD in a joint research project, I guess, between the University of Granada and University of Parma, co-supervised by Miguel Muñoz and Raffaella Burioni. And specifically during his PhD, he studied the relation between synchronization and criticality in the brain. He got his PhD in 2021, and since then is working at the Max Planck Institute for Biological Cybernetics, where he's studying how self-organization and evolution shapes computation and criticality. So please, Victor, start your presentation.
So thank you very much both for the introduction and for the invitation to allow me to talk here. First of all, can you hear me correctly? Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can hear and see the screen, please.
Perfect. So I'm going to talk mostly about the work I have been doing during my PhD with some of the extensions and novelties that came out during this last year. Basically, what we are gonna talk about is synchronization, phase transition, and the relationship with the problem of brain criticality. So I will start with a small motivation on why criticality is important and why we are concerned with criticality in biology and in particular in neuroscience. Then I will talk a bit about synchronization and different kind of synchronization phase transition, and finally we go for a small application or ideas for application in whole brain dynamics. Okay, so the first thing is, if we are going to talk about criticality and criticality hypothesis, is why this is important. Is in many physical systems we know that they have mechanisms that allow them to automatically organize them to display a scale-free phenomena or to move them near to a critical point of a second order phase transition. And this is known to happen, for example, in earthquakes and rainfall, some examples in plasma physics. So this is a very well-known phenomena in statistical physics and phase transitions. And in the last years, there has been an increased interest in applying these ideas to biological systems, because when you are near a critical point, you have properties or features like large susceptibility and large correlations, which would be beneficial because biological systems really need to act. To react to a stimuli, and they need to do that in a fast way. They need a large dynamic range in order to be able to process all information and all kind of different stimuli. And apparently, being near a critical point or near a second order phase transition, that will help them to do this thing. So there are many examples. There is a very nice review by Miguel Muñoz, 2018, in which he gives a lot of different examples. I think two of the most well-known and I think robust, they are the bird flocks that are studied in Rome. And also in bacteria, there is some examples about the ideas of percolation and being near to critical percolation in order to save the most resources possible. So in the brain, the problem is that doing experiments is not very easy, and most of our evidence comes from activity recordings, both in vitro and in vivo. And for the brain, being near to a critical point, it will be important in the same sense that it is for other biological systems. It will allow it to process information in a very efficient way. So if the brain was near at a real critical point, then this will mean that we will have a very general theory on how information process could happen and why it is so good to do this task. So our main observable for criticality is a scale-free phenomena, and in particular in the brain, since neurons are splitting activity, is avalanches. So what is an avalanche? Basically, in neuroscience, you record some activity, you put some electrodes into the brain, you record the activity from these electrodes, and you get the largest events recorded by these electrodes. Then you take all your experimental setup and you put in what is called a raster plot, in which you have time and also when these large events happened. And from this raster plot, you are able to do some analysis, which tells you if all these points happened very close in time or not. And using a time-binning procedure and some, you need to do some treatment to the data. Basically, you are able to see if there was an avalanche of activity happening at a very short time. When you do the distribution of avalanche sizes and durations, being durations like the time that the avalanche needed to complete from the start to the end, and the size, the number of electrodes that register a spike, both result to be scale-free. So this is one of the most robust evidences that we have that these avalanches are taking place and that they are scale-free, that this would be the case if the brain was critical. This is there is even more, that the slopes for these avalanches do not have any value for the exponents, but are the values for the mean field directed percolation universality class. This universality class is very well known in non-equilibrium statistical physics, because it's the universality class, for example, of the contact process, which includes a lot of non-equilibrium phenomena. Almost, I think, any system which has not strange symmetries or something like that, and has an absorbing state and an active phase, and has activity spreading, belongs to this mean field directed percolation universality class. So this seems to be in accordance with what we know about the brain, and it has been the main idea for a long time. Problem now is that there is some more recent experiments that report a set of exponents that seem to deviate more or less consistently from this result. So we have in this study from Tenelli and co-authors, for example, they plot a hyperscaling relation between sizes and durations, and you see that all the data they have for different animals and in different conditions lie in the same line, so they will all be fulfilling this this condition, and it is not consistent with the mean field directed percolation. So there is, apart from this paper, there is some other works that tend to say similar things. So the problem is that we are not sure if these are the correct exponents. We are not sure if the brain is really critical, or there is something else that is maybe producing this power loss. All these features do not include some of the phenomena that we know that is happening at the brain, like, for example, brain waves and synchronization among neurons. So there is some kind of missing pieces that we would like to understand. So for now, let's say the mean field directed percolation is the most accepted, and is the theory that it's completing the pathology in the best way. But still, there are some experiments and some things that we do not understand completely. So during my thesis, what I have been working on is in synchronization dynamics. So we want to understand what happens with synchronization in the brain, and we try to do it from what we ended calling hybrid synchronization. So the beginning of this story is this model published by the Anton collaborators in 2018, in which they have a model which is very similar to self-organized theories, in which you have a splitting activity and then a short-term synaptic plasticity. So splitting activity is similar to any splitting activity model, and short-term synaptic plasticity acts as a regulatory mechanism. And then each individual unit can have a down state or an up state, similar to any other shock theory, but they are also able to display oscillations. So each individual unit is able to behave as an oscillator. when you connect many of them, for example, in a two-dimensional lattice that will represent the cortex, you have like collective down states, collective up states, which is the typical thing, and then in the middle, then you observe new states that are either synchronous or asynchronous. And between them, there is a critical point. This critical point displays scale-free avalanches, and the authors demonstrated that it is a well-behaved synchronization phase transition. So the next question, of course, is, okay, if this is a synchronization phase transition, you are able to find scale-free avalanches, and these avalanches have exponents that are compatible with the ones that we observed at experiments, what is the universality class of this critical point? So when I started studying this problem, the first idea that we had was, okay, it's a synchronization transition, so let's try to use the simplest model that we can come up with. And for synchronization, there is the Kuramoto model, which is, I think, the simplest one that you can take, in which you have just oscillators which move with a constant frequency. Usually frequencies are taken from the distribution, but in this case, we decided to leave all the oscillators with the same frequency and add a stochastic white noise. And then there is a coupling that tries to put all the oscillators to go together. So now if the oscillators synchronize or not depend on the interplay between the coupling and the noise. You are able to assess which is the level of synchronization using the Kuramoto order parameter. And if you do some analysis, at the end, you are able to determine that the that criticality happens at the Hopf bifurcation when the square intensity of the noise is equal to the coupling. So we take all this information, and what we do is to follow the same procedure that neuroscience people do. We start by mapping our oscillators to a raster plot, basically by identifying a spike with a predefined phase. So each time the oscillator goes through the phase pi, I put a dot in this raster plot. And then I do this for the different phases. I go to the critical point and I do the distributions of avalanches for both sizes and times. And what we see is that at criticality, we do not find any scale-free avalanche for the Kuramoto model. And this contradicts both experiments and contradicts also what we find at the model by DeSanto and all the collaborators. So this means that the Hopf bifurcation and the Kuramoto model is not able to replicate the observations, and then it's not the correct universality class for the transition that we are observing. Also, we are doing new analysis on these synchronization systems and how this way of measuring avalanches affects what are the results in different setups and with some variations, and we are very close to have some results that I would like to show you, but still they need some processing, and I hope that they will be ready for next month. But I think that this is not the end of the story, and there is still a lot to explore in this thing. So coming back to the question of what is the universality class of the Landau-Ginzburg and maybe the real data, is, okay, the Kuramoto model does not work, so what can we do? And the idea was, let's try to add some excitability to the oscillators. Excitability is an ingredient that we know that is present in neuronal systems. It is one of the key features of neuronal systems, and it is very easy to add to a system of couple oscillators just by adding this A sign of phi here, which basically what does is changing the system to non-linear set of oscillators. Now, each individual oscillator has itself a bifurcation, which is called a SNIC bifurcation, and if the excitability is too large, allows the oscillator to get stuck at some point, okay? So if the excitability is low, then you are able to go around, and if excitability is too large, then you get stuck. A lot of part of this study was to analyze the macroscopic dynamics of this system. We were able to do this analytically using a couple oscillator theory. So basically the idea is to write Fokker-Penn equation, expand it in Fourier harmonics, and then from this you are able to use a closure maybe to get something that is analytically more tractable. So in this paper, which is already published and available, you are able to see all the steps that we did, and we tried with different closures that are not the old Antonsen standard. We tried with some new things, so there is a lot of information, like new information, let's say, about this kind of oscillators right here. So let's go to the results. When you do all this procedure, you find this infinite set of differential equations that, as I said, you can close with odd Antonsen or any other modern closure. And if not, you can just integrate these equations. Here I present some numerical results coming directly from simulations of the whole stochastic system. And we find is a synchronous phase, and there is an asynchronous phase and also some collective excitability. Numerical results are not able to distinguish very well between these two phases, but they are different. And in analytics, you can do it. So we combine this with analytical results here in this small region, because here it is very difficult to discern what's going on. So this is very small green triangle is determined using analytics. And here you have this small region that is surrounded by codimension two bifurcations. So this type two bifurcation, it is the Hopf bifurcation that we saw before. Okay, that you have it here, the raster plot is exactly the same as the thing I showed you before. Then there is this type one, which is again the sneak bifurcation, and it is reminiscent of the one of the single unit, because if everybody is synchronous, they act as if they were a single oscillator. So if excitability is very high, then they can go through this sneak bifurcation. You see that what happens here is that they are very well synchronous, and as you get closer to the bifurcation, the burst between the dots become larger and larger, so the period increases until there is no more activity. And inside this instability region, we find the what we call a hybrid type bifurcation. This hybrid type because it's not type one, it's not type two. The nomenclature is taken also from excitability classes in neuroscience, that they are in this way. And basically what you see is that in this small region, the dynamics are different. They have a instability between a down state and a limit cycle. So you can be in an excitable phase in which nothing happens or very low amount of neurons are spiking. And then here the system jumps to the limit cycle. You have some partial synchronization for some time and then falls back again to the down. And this happens stochastically. So you have transitions between one and the other in a very stochastic way. Then we just take each one of the transitions and we ask ourselves, are they different, for example, from the point of view of the universality classes? What happens with the avalanches? So we have the raster plots, we do avalanches, and then you are able to see that the only one that displays scale-free avalanches is the hybrid type bifurcation. The SNIC seems to be a good candidate too, but check that most of the distribution is around one bump here, because it has a very well-defined time scale. All nodes are very well synchronized, and then it's in principle there should not be any criticality in this way. We have done all the typical checks like fine excess scaling. We check also the hyperscaling relation that was done in the Fontenelle paper, for example. We find similar values for the exponent gamma, and we check that they are also like kind of compatible with the ones that were found previously at the Landau-Ginzburg model by this et al. So this is a very good candidate to be the explanation, at least what is happening with the model. Okay. Real data is more complicated, and this does not fulfill all the requirements and not all the observations of the data. For example, correlation length do not scale very well, which is a thing that we see in data. But I mean, this is still work in progress, and maybe some ingredients may be still absent. However, we are happy because this system is this kind of dynamics is not something particular of our system. It's something that you can find in many other neuroscience systems, like the Wilson-Cowan dynamics. This has a very similar phase diagram. Also, theta neurons, when you have excitatory and inhibitory theta neurons, they also display very similar dynamics and very similar phase diagrams. So this is something that you can find actually in many places if you look a bit for them in neuroscience. So it is not something very particular of our model and can be found in many neuroscience setups. I also wanted to comment a bit about this recent archive from Lombardi et al., which take the original Landau-Ginzburg model, which I write here completely for comparison, and they simplify it. So basically what they do is, instead of self-organizing this R, they self-organize this small threshold of the input function, and they simplify this the synaptical resources part, let's say. So this simplification allows them to do fits with the data and check how well the model goes with the data. They also check for critical dynamics in this case. So I would like to remark that the way that they compute exponents is different from the way that we do, and it's done in neuroscience experiments. Okay, so the exponents here seem to be, to my side, more related to the fact that they have a random walk kind of exponents, because they have white noise, and the way that they are measuring seems to be like compatible with having a random walk. This is something that is just simply different. So, for example, it will be difficult maybe to directly compare this this thing with the resource that we have. But they also do a lot of fits with data. They have the paper with a lot of figures showing how they fit the model, how well it goes with the data, and it seems to be very, very nice. So I'm kind of happy to see this thing in the literature building up from the ingredients and comparatively doing a comparison directly with the data, because it's something that we haven't done yet, and not in such a direct way. So I think this is a very good direction. So finally, I would like to do a fast comment on applications to whole brain models, because most of the criticality discussion is focused on criticality in the cortex, but the brain has different scales, and oscillators have been applied historically to whole brain models more than just the cortex. So there is a large literature like just using, for example, the Kuramoto model in the connectome, or using oscillators to represent different neuronal areas. And what they find is that there is a huge frustration in the synchronization. So not all the oscillators are able to synchronize. This is due to the topological, structural organization of the brain, because it is hierarchical modular. And this leads to a whole phase that has critical-like properties. And this has been called a Griffith phase. So it could be that criticality is also happening at the larger scales, not just only at the cortex. It is not maybe just related to these avalanches, but it's something that could be happening at larger scales. So the usual way to work in this case is that you start with any model, you do what is called a phase reduction. So you are able to change your equations to just a one-dimensional oscillator thing. You are able, if you use just a phase, you have something like this. If you have phase and amplitude for your oscillators, you have the normal form of the Hopf bifurcation, and then you feed this to the structural connectivity data, and allows you to get observables and compare your observables with the ones that you have at the experiments. So this has been done in many, many papers, and the results are kind of interesting. They say, for example, that if you feed the parameters, if you do a fit of the parameters for each region, then each region seems to be similar to. I'm sorry. So at the end, what you get is that the best fit is near to a synchronization critical point, which is near a. Since we are using the Hopf bifurcation, this is near to. Since we are using the normal form, the best fit is near to where the bifurcation happens. And this will be more or less in favor of a synchronization transition. The problem is that most of the papers and most of the literature is using directly the Hopf bifurcation to do the study. So the only kind of bifurcation that you can analyze or that you can check is the Hopf. And as I have presented before, we have different kind of bifurcations that could have different properties. And also, at least in the cortex, in the case of escape-free dynamics, in the way that is measured in neuroscience, Hopf does not seem to be the best candidate. So one thing that we have been checking is that what happens when we go from Erdos Renyi to hierarchical modular topologies, and we check with two different kinds of hierarchical modular topologies that are considered realistic, and we check what happens with all the different bifurcations using our previous model. And the idea was to evaluate how dynamical richness changes, which is associated, for example, with the how wide the distribution of Fano factor is. And you see that even if you can have good results with the Hopf in the synchronous phase, for example, due to the Griffith phase, also with the hybrid kind of transition, with the SNIC transition, especially in the core periphery network, you can have also very rich dynamics. And the image of the raster plots seem to be quite different. So I think that there is a lot of things to explore here, because most of the work has been done in, I would say, of bifurcations. But still, there is a lot of freedom if we let our models to have different kinds of transitions. So just to finish, I would say that criticality could play a fundamental role in biological systems in order to explain in a general way how they get the response to stimuli, how evolution might be selecting these states. In the case of the brain, it could be that it is working near a critical point. Up to now, the most robust result is the mean field directed percolation in universality class, but there are some experiments that are challenging a bit this explanation, and we have proposed and tried to study the problem from a synchronization type perspective, just because we know that synchronization is one of the key features of the brain. The result is that the Hopf bifurcation does not seem to render power loss distributions, and excitability is a necessary ingredient in order to recover this power loss. So this opens a lot of doors because of the new dynamics to study what happens in the macroscopic state. And just to finish, I would like to thank you all for listening to my talk, the organizers again for these nice seminars, and of course to my ex-supervisors and collaborators for during all this work. So thank you very much for listening. And now I think it's time for questions.
Okay, thank you very much, Victor. Are there comments or questions?
Well, I have a question.
Oh, please, yes.
If I understand that you are using white noise, is it mm-hmm. so? And what happens if you are using, for instance, some kind of colored noise? Are the results... So another question is, why white noise? Okay. And what happens if instead you use a different noise?
That's a very nice question. We have selected white noise because it is the easiest in order to treat, especially for analytical results. Is way easier to treat, for example, than colored noise. But it is true that it's not the most realistic choice. In our case, for example, we know that multiplicative noise, still if it is white but has some multiplicative thing, that will be important. And yet in the oscillators model, we have not included it. In the Landau-Yeithmur model, it is included, but we have not used it later. So that could be important. About colored noise, I have not seen much about that. I know there is a pair of works of yeah, there is a pair of works in the literature that were using this discorrelated noise to study some, for example, the stability up and down states, which seem to be very important in the brain and also correlated with distance of the avalanches. And then the correlation time will help, for example, the system to be sustaining one of these two states. So if you have some correlated noise, this will help the system to be in the up state for more time and then go back to the down state, depending on how correlated your noise are. But this is something that I would believe that is yet to explore, actually.
Okay, thanks.
Other questions or comments? I have a question, just a curiosity, not even a question. So in almost all the models that you have been presenting are models where, let's say, the single element is homogeneous, is of the same type. Have you, I mean, are there models where you have, let's say, or heterogeneity or some kind of internal frustration or other things like that?
Yes, for example, in this model with active rotators, we tried also to consider some heterogeneity here. It does not fundamentally change the results, depending, of course, on the distribution that you put, because then you have a completely new degree of freedom that you can that you can put here, right? But if you put, for example, a Gaussian unimodal distribution which does not have like long tails or whatever for the frequencies, we know that the results qualitatively do not change. So we have tried to use this, and this, I believe, this is a very important point in the case of the hierarchical modular network, because it is not the same to have a core or a node that is very important and has a lot of weight in the network with a certain frequency that might be an outlier than having it in the average. So heterogeneity, I think that in the more realistic case, it will be also a key player, but still we have to go little by little in order to understand all the details before just putting everything together.
Okay. So thank you. Any other question or comments? So if not, I think it's time to thank again both Lorenzo and Victor, and then say bye to all of us, I would say. Ciao, ciao.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you all. Bye.
Ciao.